And some certainly news surrounding the Dallas Stars. Anton Khudobin getting a start tonight because Ben Bishop, he started last night but left the game in the second period with what they're calling a lower body injury. The diagnosis right now, day-to-day. Weeksy, can this team win moving forward without Ben Bishop if he's going to miss a significant amount of time?
Well, Ben Bishop's their number one goalie. There's no question about that. Ben Bishop, for me right now, is also a Vezina Trophy finalist right now. You take a look at the numbers, especially the save percentage, shutouts. I thought he had a chance to be an all-star this season, but he's been great. Just established a franchise record, eclipsing the great Eddie Belfour. Now, the good news or the silver lining is twofold. Number one, from what I was told from people close to the situation, it's something that he's been dealing with. It's been a lingering lower body thing for him. So maybe this affords him the opportunity to get it right, to heal. Number two, the other silver lining is Anton Khudobin has been absolutely lights out.
Really good.
Coming in with a .924 save percentage, 15 saves and 16 shots last night. So they're in a good position where the goaltending is concerned. But Jamal, of course. I mean, I think Dallas can be a disruptor in the playoffs. I think they could potentially upset somebody's party, and that's going to have to be done by Ben Bishop. In the event that he can't go, they're fortunate in the fact that they do have Anton Khudobin. But, of course, I feel they go deeper with Ben Bishop. He's their ace, and you can make a case that he's been their best player this year.
I agree with you. When I look at the goalies in the West, the two guys that really stand out, this man, Ben Bishop. I hope that's Ben Bishop. Okay.
Yep.
Thank you, it is. Number one. And number two, of course, Marc-Andre Fleury.
Yep. Yeah.
These
right.
guys could be spoilers for a lot of people. Doesn't matter where these teams fit. If your goalie can outplay the other goalie, you got a chance to move on.
Mm-hmm. All right, five games left. Obviously, the game tonight in Edmonton, then coming up on Saturday in Vancouver, then after that at home against Philly, Chicago, and Minnesota. If your injury and a goaltender's injury right now is day-to-day, what does that mean as far as how many games does he need back under his belt before the playoffs hit?
That'll all be based upon how he feels. Yeah. How he feels. They'll be in regular contact with him. Jim Montgomery, Jeff Reese, our goalie coach, Rick Bonus, the whole staff and the medical staff, along with Ben Bishop, of course, getting a gauge on how he's feeling. And I really think now for Ben Bishop, the key is to make sure that he gets right, 100% right. And even if he gets one start, or maybe he gets two, but if he can at least get one start before the playoffs, based on his body of work this year, I'd feel confident provided that he's 100% healthy.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's not unlike what's going on with Fleury right now.
Right.
You know, I mean, he's missed a number of games here. They got a big game coming up against Minnesota. Then they play San Jose, who they could potentially catch, but it's not impossible, but it feels improbable at this stage. So what do you do with those guys? Exactly the same. Make sure they're 100% right. Don't play them until then. If you have to... If you have to wait to the end, I think it's fine. I really do. These guys are in game shape, so to speak, already.
And another silver lining is that sometimes the injury, you get a little rest, you know?
Sure.
These guys have played a whole lot of hockey, so as long as you can continue to pick up points and stay in the playoff hunt, maybe you get a little freshness as playoffs hits, and then your aces are right back between the pipes. Meanwhile, we turned our attention to another team who has maybe their sights set on next season. The Panthers coming off that 6-1 trouncing against Montreal on Tuesday night. That officially eliminated them from playoff contention this year. You take a look at some of the quotes that came out of that room on Tuesday night, and yikes, there is definitely some accountability there. Starting with this guy, Alexander Barkov. With this team, I think we should have made the playoffs. It's disappointing if you don't. We have a bright future and we're still young. But time goes by really fast. We have to start right out from the beginning of the season and win games. Of course, it's frustrating when you don't make the playoffs. The biggest goal before the season and during the season is to win games and make the playoffs and win the Stanley Cup. When you don't make them, you're frustrated. So certainly some frustration there for the Florida Panthers. If you're Barkov and company, what has to happen between now and the start of next season for you to take that next step forward, Lotz?
First of all, I completely disagree with him. I don't think they should have made the playoffs. I just don't think their defensive core is up to snuff. If you want to be a playoff team, I think they've misevaluated some players. They've made some changes there. It's a below average decor. And I don't know how you could sit there and expect. Now, I know as a player, of course, you want to be in the playoffs. Of course, he's speaking from the heart. But the fact of the matter is, I did not see it that way. I'm sorry. And I think it was really evident the last couple games here where the team dropped the level in terms of their work ethic. And they were kind of embarrassed, in my opinion. As a group on a nightly basis, I didn't like the way it ended for them. Their magic number was four. They lost their last two games in not real impressive fashion, to say it nicely. But at the end of the day, I believe that this is a team that will be in the playoffs next year when they go to work on reevaluating where their decor is actually at, upgrade it if they can, which I expect they fully can this summer, and then give me those comments and I'll agree with you. But right now, I don't agree with Barkov on them.
You agree?
That's a little harsh, but that's the way I see it. You asked, so I'll answer.
Yeah, exactly.
I love the honesty.
At different parts of the season, yeah. I did. Especially given how great Roberto Luongo was playing, but then he was besieged by injury. And once Luongo went down, there's no way that I thought that they could have sustained that playoff aspiration just because, you know, he's out of the lineup, and then it puts a lot of strain on James Reimer, and then Montembeau's getting in and playing some games and been pretty impressive as a young guy, but that's a lot to heap on his shoulders. Those are a lot of lost points in the absence of Luongo at different points of the season. So I think that they're exactly where they should be. But there are some rays of hope for that team. I do think that they've got some great pieces led by Barkov, but they're going to have to add to that.
We saw the playoffs and their success in the playoffs the last 6 years. Yeah. Hasn't been a whole lot of playoffs, right. But there was one. They won the Atlantic Division, and then kind of the wheels fell off. They made all kinds of changes and tinkering. Yeah. What happened, and why did they get away from what was working down there?
Nobody really knows what happened other than they had a significant change in philosophy as to how they were running their organization, and it set them back, quite frankly, and now they're back to the way they were, but it takes time. You can't turn the Titanic on a dime. They found that out this year. I know there's a lot of disappointment down there. I know there's disappointment with the ownership, with the coaches, with the manager, but they've got to stick with it, and if they can address that decor, because you're exactly right, Weeksy, they do have a lot of bright spots. Mm-hmm. Anytime you can field Barkov and Trocheck down the middle, just feel good about that right off the start. Not to mention Dadonov, Hoffman, the job they did. They've got a lot of bright pieces in place. They still need to supplement it.
Yeah, they definitely do. I mean, if you look at the offseason now, if you're Dale Tallon and you're scouring the landscape of what's available, not only by
way of... a lot about Bob and Panarin as a package duo down there.
Yeah. There's been a lot of talk about that.
I find that curious so much talk about that.
But if you look at the board, if you look at the board as an example, I mean, you look at the goalies that are available, there's certainly options to be able to add and help stabilize the net. And, of course, the great unknown is what the great Roberto Luongo, future Hall of Famer, is going to choose to do. So they're going to have to sit down. They owe him that in terms of the discussion. He's earned that right. He's one of the best that's ever done it. And see what type of a common ground they can come to by way of what the future will hold. And then if you looked at that board again, there are some good pieces. There are some good potential players in the marketplace if you want to go UFA and not give up any assets. And if you want to get creative by way of trades, the Panthers do have some pieces that they would be able to potentially move. So it's a huge offseason for them. Lots, I'm with you. Elevate the goaltending, definitely improve the decor.
Yep.
And then once you get up to the forward group, they have 2.5 lines right now. You got to be a four-line team in the National Hockey League to be consistent on a nightly basis. So improve their bottom six, the decor, and add another goalie to the mix. And I think that Bob Bugner and Dale Tallon and the Panthers could be in pursuit of a playoff spot should they do those things in the offseason.
Yeah, I like the prospects for them. I just think when you look at that board right there, you say, wow, that's some really good forwards. There's some good options in the goaltending market as well, but there's not a lot on D. So what does that mean? It means go out and get the free assets that you can. Mm-hmm. Go back to your roster and start moving some of the good pieces that you do have that you can supplement with UFA players to bring in some D, which is badly needed, because you're not going to find that on the open market the way you'd like to. If they go with that plan, and Dale Tallon is exactly the type of guy that could pull that off and pull it off well, I think they'll be in a good spot next year.
If you go back and you take a look at this Washington game and some of the stuff that they were able to do in their speed and a few mistakes, you get it done. But Washington will make you pay for some of the smallest little prices. And they did that in this game against Carolina.
Yeah, they certainly did. And scoring a key goal at 15:04, the third, the difference maker here, Billy.
And if you take it through this and you get it down here, you stop here. All of a sudden you have the defenseman here, DeHaan in. Now you have a forward back here in support. Pay attention to the forward. He's not used to playing D. Go, roll it. So you get the forward back there. All of a sudden, he thinks, oh, I'm just going to stand and catch a jump pass. Nope. All of a sudden, two on Wayne. You mentioned it here. Now, stop here. Why do defensemen fall on the ice and lay out? Just pretend he's on his feet. This is Ven Riemsdyk. Go. If he stays on his feet here, he has to recover. If he's on his feet, he's able to make that play against Connolly Exceptional patience by Connolly. Does that stop here? You know, this is Verona here. Pay attention to the speed. He can go, and this is what Verona's speaking. Now stop here. You get the defenseman here peeking in, and you got all this white ice for Verona. And it just takes that little peek. Go. Oh, and I'm caught to the outside. Just can't get back. And the bad poke check by McElhaney. And the best one is this third one. This is maybe one of the best shifts I love. Now stop here. You get Dowd. You get this chip off the boards and in. But you have to pay attention to Dowd the whole way on the shift. Number 26 in white. Go. So not only does he dump it in, he beats Hamilton to the puck. He gets a little elbow to the head of Aho. Now he goes into the battle, the corner with Aho, and stop again here. So now you get mano a mano here. Go. Dowd takes a cross check. He's down on his knees. Who wants to get to the front of the net more? Dowd, I'm gonna go to the front of the net. And they got a lot of production from their fourth line last year, did Washington?
Yeah, they did.
But that shift by Dowd for a game-winning goal, marvelous.
Yeah, it was
just the chip Aho, and the work.
But Aho
that
did.
They have.
Aho did good work on his man.
Yeah, until he stopped skating to the front of the net.
When he played it around the boards, he was expecting his winger to be there. Yeah. Maybe he fired a little bit too hard.
Yep.
And yeah, then I think he lost sight of the fact that that could be picked off by the defenseman. It was a good alert play by the Washington Capitals. And certainly Dowd deserves a lot of credit. Anytime you beat your man to the net and you score a goal, you deserve it.
And it was on the dump in the whole way. And that
keeping
kind
it straight,
and
huh?
That kind of work.
Yeah.
Keeping it straight.
The one on two.
It was. And go back to that Tampa game at home, Washington, where they had the 50 shots or whatever, and they dominated Tampa Bay 5-on-5. Mm-hmm. And you're starting to see this again from the Capitals, this work ethic up and down the lineup. Tom Wilson, Ovechkin, Dowd, their fourth line. You get Hagelin in onto that third line. Everyone's talking about Boston and the ability. The defending Stanley Cup champions, be aware. Be really aware. Mm-hmm. Holtby, he's starting to find
last
that
year,
groove.
At this point, he was being rested. Because Grubauer was taking over the
show. You can see they got that game face on, and they are champions, and they are starting to play like they want to remain the champions of the NHL.
So the Caps sweep the season series against the Canes, hit the 100-point mark this season, and also continue some streaks, fifth consecutive playoff berth. And Braden Holtby, the goaltender you just mentioned, now 30-plus wins for a fifth straight year as well, just the 12th goalie to do that all the time.
He's a gamer. You know, when he didn't start the first two games last year against Columbus, he didn't sit and pout. You know, he knew he wasn't playing well down the stretch. He was the ultimate teammate. And by the end of it, he ended up being the goalie, of course, and winning the Stanley Cup. And a big moment for Holtby, but it shows you a lot about his character and what kind of a team guy he is as well.
Banger, can I ask you a question?
Absolutely.
So you see that old school save where he just stands up and kicks it out.
Yep.
To me, it reminds me of Marty Brodeur. He does. You see all the...
He's got a lot of similarities.
So you see the traditional NHL goaltender go into the butterfly position almost automatically. Yeah. Braden Holtby will go down one leg sometimes, but does he have the ability to surprise shooters because they don't know that he's automatically going to go down, stand up? I think he provides an uncertainty when you're shooting the puck. All of a sudden, he shot the puck and just made a leg save. So, to me, that makes him unique and different from a lot of today's big netminders.
I think when you're on your game, Billy, a goalie sees that puck slowly coming off a stick and doesn't overreact right away. And by being patient like that, I think you can tell confidence, or a goaltender that doesn't have confidence, he goes down right away because he's uncertain where that puck's coming off the stick, and he just doesn't have that calmness to see that puck coming into him. So I think that was a really good example. Either that or he got frozen on the shot and got lucky with his left toe. I don't know, but I do know he made it look relatively easy there.
They say better lucky than good,
better good than lucky.
Well, also good and lucky at the same time. Braden Holtby is that. A massive game with huge playoff implications in the Eastern Conference, the wild card race, Panger. And at the start, it was all Habs. The first half of the first period, it was completely dominated by the road team. But then the Jackets turned it on and never let up.
Well, whenever you're the home team, too, there's pressure. You're behind by Montreal by 2 points. Everyone knows what's on the line in a game like this, Billy. And the fact of the matter is, at the beginning, I was a little concerned for the Columbus Blue Jackets. I thought the buzzing of the Montreal Canadiens was solid. I thought there was a little apprehension and maybe a little anxiety as well in the building. You're looking at it. It's a 0-0 game, and then you're down by one. But the Columbus Blue Jackets, I think they showed their mettle. I thought they came up with a big boy game. When they needed that kind of game, they won the board battles. They sort of gained a lot of momentum off of this shift in particular, Billy, that we were watching this going, okay, now this is how you beat Montreal. A much smaller team up front, a quick team on the forecheck, a team that relies on four lines. But if you've got the size and you've got the brawn along the boards, you've got to eliminate them. I thought the crowd in Columbus, after that shift in particular, late in the second, I thought the crowd got going. I thought the energy got going. There was a buzz. And then I thought some confidence kind of followed in after that shift in particular.
Here's what happened. A really bad first period by Columbus. Yep. Montreal came out, clogged up the neutral zone, turnover after turnover, eventually got their first goal off a turnover in transition. They had some hustle plays by Montreal. They're getting outworked. All of a sudden, you go in that dressing room, torch whatever was said. This Columbus team came out, and they were a much different team, much more physical, much more prepared, and they had that emotion and passion. It was not there in the first period, which, to your point, I'm concerned. Yeah. Where is this in this big game? So you get this early with Montreal, and this is a team, Montreal, you think, ready to play. Deneau coming back on the back check against Panarin. This is stuff. Jonathan Drouin against Seth Jones, just not letting up. And this was constant. Look at the shot total, the halfway through the first period. It's 7-0 for the Canadiens. Shea Weber in front of his net. We got five Montreal Canadiens in front of your screen.
Look at that.
able to battle it out. And Montreal dictated the first period. So all of a sudden you go to the dressing room, and that switch got turned on big time by the Blue Jackets.
Quick question, Panger.
Yeah.
When a defenseman makes a play like that for you,
in front of you?
Do you owe him a meal like Shea Weber?
You're a team. You're buying cold ones. You know, you're buying meals. You know, at that particular point, though, when we watch it, we're saying that's a team that's all in. There's five men in the picture right there. Almost five white sweaters inside the crease helping out their goaltender. It was all out desperation at that point. But, Bill, the start to the Montreal Canadiens, and in talking to their coaches and you talk to their players, yesterday I had a good talk with Kirk Muller. They rely on four lines. Mm-hmm. They rely on energy and forechecking. And I can't help but think, Paul Byron's injured right now. He averages nearly 15 minutes a night. He's got 15 goals. He's a plus player. He's got three game-winning goals and two shorthanded goals. They needed that spark. I'm not saying that would have been the ultimate difference in a game like this. I think Columbus would have worn them down if they played that game that they played in the second period. But, boy, it was an ill-advised time, I think, for a player of such value with so much on the line for the Montreal Canadiens.
Montreal Canadiens average, if you look at their ice time, their top guys play around 16, 17 minutes. Their bottom guys play around 12 minutes. They play four lines, and they rely on that tempo and pressure to kind of go after that. That was prevalent in that first period. That's their game plan. They're not very talented. But all of a sudden, you get a Columbus team that's going to match that work ethic, and you're going to be able to come out there with their own tempo and roll four lines. Columbus has got a more talented team. Montreal's gotten by playing that hard system, going after teams. Carey Price has been brilliant. Sergei Bobrovsky, what can you say about him in his recent stretch? But this Columbus team, if they play like this and play committed as a group, this felt like a team. This is one of those games that it seems like it's all come together with the trade pieces and everything starting to fit recently, what Columbus is starting to do, and the emotion from John Tortorella on the bench.
Yeah.
You could
see that play by Andrew Shaw.
Even after that fifth goal, he's doing the fist pump down the bench.
Before the second period, he was fired up. He was like Josh Anger before a show, Josh Anderson, getting him ready to go, and they brought it.
So you know, that emotion boom.
Every player contributed in this victory. And it also came on the heels, guys, on home ice of a poor goal against Sergei Bobrovsky on the short side by Petrie. And when that happens and you're on home ice, you could feel a... You know, it's complete momentum sapper, but yet the resilience of this hockey club came through at the end, and they didn't seem to be bothered by that goal that he gave up against Petrie. So,
and how much has Bobrovsky helped them out in the recent stretch? They got the confidence in the kid.
Three shutouts in his last five, and he was obviously strong here.
This guy gave up a bad one. Let's pick him up because he's picked him up three, four games.
Boone Jenner laid it on the line, and big shot block with an empty net, you know, right there. So everybody was all in tune on the defensive side of it as well.
So 6-2 the final, five unanswered goals for the Blue Jackets. They have three straight victories. They're, 5-2-1 in the last eight, and they now own the second and final wild card spot in the Eastern Conference playoff race. It was a big tilt, and it goes to CBJ.
Well, that's one big turn of events, and you can see the anguish of the fans in Winnipeg after that great play by Eberle. And on this particular play, coming out of their own zone, you can see Barzal skating and gaining the line. It was an easy entry into the zone. No gap closure whatsoever by the Winnipeg Jets. And then Eberle with a nice little move, faking to his left and going back to his right on the forehand right here. Little stutter step maneuver right there. Anders Lee's in front of the net. Hellebuck bites on it. But boy, oh boy, the Winnipeg Jets not defending very well.
And what happens there is with Barzal, once he splits those both D, he doesn't score. But both D have the other one, Kulikov got beaten, and the other one has to come over and recover. And all of a sudden, you have two defensemen behind the net, and the slot is left wide open. And that's the skill of Barzal on display there, that individual skill. But if he's taken away originally, all of a sudden, you see this. I saw it on the third goal and see it on that last goal. Mm. Once you start to do other players' jobs,
it's not good, right?
No, then it starts to break down.
Here's that third goal you're talking about, Billy.
Yeah, so now this is a play here. This is hard work. Everything's going good. So it's going to get back, and it's going to get down low. And what's going to happen here defensively for Winnipeg is you're going to start to do other players' jobs. Now stop here. Now you have Lowry here. He is responsible for the defenseman up here. So what happens now is now there's going to be the other player thinks, oh, what? This is going to be a breakdown. I got to get over here and help out. Well, who is left wide open? The defenseman. Pulak. This is doing other players' jobs. Roll it. Now watch it. Think, oh, I got to do someone else's. Look at that. You just have to do your own job, and then Eberle's open in front. And that just happened on the last goal. You had two defensemen down behind the net because one guy got beat. If that one guy gets beat, just let him go. Just stop in front of the net. If you're Winnipeg, you get in all kinds of trouble there. You see the winger Lowry get too tight to the boards and chasing over in the middle, and then Pulak, the defenseman, wide open, rebound. But in hockey, it's just, if you watch the real good, just constant. If there's one breakdown, don't compound it with another breakdown. That's when you get those multiple breakdowns, goals end up in the back of your net.
Sherratt looked a little dazed behind that net, though.
Yeah.
I mean, earlier on that play, and I know they were talking about it, is that it did look like he was slew-foot. His visor was all banged up, and he could trying to get his stick down there. By the time he got to the front of the net, and then Patrick Laine not aware of what's going on, and Laine misses Cizikas going right to the crease, and he taps it in quite easily. But I go back to the strength of the Winnipeg Jets at the beginning of the year, their matchups. I mean, again, we go back to Morrissey. You can see without Morrissey, Trouba is a tandem. Sherratt and Byfuglien play well together, and Morrow and Myers, as an example, at the beginning of the year when they're having success, they just don't look like a team right now that's feeling the confidence of the forwards coming back, and therefore the D might not be trusting that. That's why you're seeing them back off the line. Defensemen like the Winnipeg Jets are one of the best teams in the league at holding lines, holding the red line, holding the blue line, but they do so because their forwards come back right through the middle of the ice. And I don't get that sense right now. And the Edmonton Oilers are taking advantage of it.
Yeah, Winnipeg, as Billy Madison once said, you blew it. But you got to get
that. Was
that was a lot.
That's a little
that was
harsh, huh?
That was too much. Oof. You have to give credit where it's due, and the credit goes to the Islanders.
They are working
for a Duncan NHL comeback because they were down at one point, fellas, 4-2. And starting with that third goal that Billy just broke down for us, they began to storm back and eventually defeat the Jets by a final of 5-4.
Impressive work ethic in the third period by the Islanders. And this is a team that has struggled to score all year.
Are two defensemen supposed to be behind the net like that?
No.
Oh.
No. And Myers
is double-checking?
Yeah, look at the reaction of Kulikov there, 5, and then Myers. They both just look skyward. And good to see Barzal going. He got a goal. It was goalless in 19 games coming in. So going. And the Islanders just continue to surprise you. They usually win the games 2-1. It's fun to see them win a shootout game. It is. Yeah. It's nice to see them win a shootout game.
A shootout after being shut out in 3 of the past 5 coming into tonight. Islanders win 5-4. Overtime game winner presented by EA Sports NHL 19. Panger, what a night for Bertuzzi.
Yeah, really a big night there. Obviously, this is a pretty goal right here. And you can see head up all the way, waiting. Little dish right there. Now you've got your classic 3-on-2 with the late man coming in here. And a really nice pass by DeKeyser. Pretty obvious play. But the Buffalo Sabres don't defend that with a forward coming back. Bertuzzi actually got knocked in the nose there earlier in the game. And he was gushing blood and his eyes were streaming water.
Panger, take me through Allmark here. Is he ducking? Is he? Please tell me, is that no, is what, that how you play goal?
What he's trying coming to do a, is he? He's imitating my height. So he's listen, trying to be 5 foot four and a half right here.
I've never seen a goalie duck.
He lost this. You know what he did? He lost his balance.
But he still looked like he didn't want to take it in the melon.
Yeah, but
I don't blame him.
You know what? I mean, personally, balance is everything in a lot of things. Balance is everything in the stance in golf. Balance is everything in a goaltender. He moves side to side, and then he falls forward like so many goalies do. I think the timing was perfect to make it look like that, although I did give up one over my head and under the bar and in one time. The old six hole, I think Doug Wilson once called it. But I was standing up.
Yeah. Standing up. What a tough run for Buffalo.
That 10 winning 10 in a row,
streak.
Yeah.
And it's gone. But they've made some improvements in their team. But you looked at 10-game winning streak, all of a sudden this hope, it got built way up. Buffalo, really disappointed.
Yeah,
me
too.
Happened after that 10-game winning streak.
Yeah, you can't.
Everything they had.
Yeah, you're right about that. But they probably learned a lot about themselves. The pressure's on when you win 10 and you climb up above the standings, and then this happens. So I'm sure there's a lot of pressure on everyone in that organization now to make sure that they at some point become a playoff contending team.
We're looking at building blocks for both those organizations. He's one of them. Bertuzzi, a beautiful goal. Sick goal, as B. Myers called it in our ear during that highlight. As we step aside for a brief timeout here on NHL Tonight. When we come back, it's all about the Caps and the Canes. Washington trying to clinch a spot in the postseason, as if there was a doubt. But stick with us for the highlights from this one.
Time for the NHL Hat-Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise. Alongside Kevin Weeks, I'm Jameson Coyle. Got to ask, how did we do last night?
Last night wasn't as fruitful.
Oh, okay. Well, let's back the Chiquita truck up and get some more fruit on board here.
Let's do it.
Preds, Penguins, good tilt. Who wins?
I'm going to go with the Preds because they haven't been their best of late. There's something off with the Nashville Predators when I watch their game right now. The power play is one thing, but the urgency of which Peter Laviolette loves his teams to play with isn't fully there up and down the lineup, and that's got to turn down the stretch. So I'm going to go with the Preds. They've got room to improve, and I'm thinking that they're going to improve.
All right, this one's right in your wheelhouse. Philip Grubauer, at least 30 saves. What do you think?
I'll say yes. He's going to need to. I mean, he's going to have to continue standing on his head for every opportunity that he's earned down the stretch. He's been great. His last six starts have been tremendous. So, too, have been the ads in front of him. He looks laser sharp right now, and focused. I love his game right now.
All right. Vegas Golden Knights taking on the Minnesota Wild. Does Vegas score at least 3 goals in this game?
I say they do. I mean, the Vegas Golden Knights are a more balanced team. I've spoken to some members of their front office, and they love their team even more so now with the addition of Mark Stone, the way that the players are slotted in. They're in their right spots, and everybody's healthy for the Vegas Golden Knights, which is important as well. So I say that they get 3 for sure.
All right. I feel good about these.
Yeah, me too.
I think the fruitfulness
feel it in your bones, James.
Back. Oh, it's yes, we're
feel
there.
It in your bones.
All right, you got the Preds. You have Grubauer going to work, making at least 30 saves, and you've got the Golden Knights scoring at least 3 goals in that game against Minnesota. You can play NHL Hat-Trick.
Go get that gold, ladies. Time now for your 3 stars of the night. Third star goes to Detroit's Tyler Bertuzzi, who had 3 points, including the game-winning goal in the Wings' overtime victory at Buffalo. It's Bertuzzi's third career 3-point game. Our second star goes to Chicago's Alex DeBrincat, who scored twice in the Hawks' 5-4 win in San Jose. The 21-year-old scoring phenom is the youngest Hawk in team history to reach 40 goals in one season. And your first star of the night goes to the Islanders' Jordan Eberle, who scored twice, including the game winner in New York's victory at Winnipeg. Eberle added a helper against the Jets for his first 3-point contest of the season.
Brady Keeper making his NHL debut. It's a proud night.
Quinn ready for his first NHL game.
Quinn Hughes makes a quick dash, takes the puck behind the net, banks it to himself. Hughes shoots, stopped by Quick. Rebound, they score! And they're going to have to grab that puck. Quinn Hughes has his first point in the NHL.
Niederreiter off the side of the goal. They score!
Unreal end-to-end rush for Colin White.
That's hockey, baby! What a goal by rookie Warren Fogle.
That's a beautiful goal.
And what a move in tight. That's a highlight reel one there.
Bring it back between the legs, tuck it top shelf on the blocker's side.
Artemi Panarin buries it. Make me a big loaf bread, man.
Washington clinching the playoff berth.
Drag, he's in for a power move, he scores! That's hockey, baby! What a goal by rookie Warren Fogle, Carolina, with a 2-1 lead.
Wow, what a goal.
Well, the
Foligno's got help on the rush, and he drops it back for Dubinsky over to Savard. He shoots and scores! Top shelf Savard! Tied at one, David Savard!
What a goal there for David Savard as he ripped that.
Jets on the power play. Truba fires wide. Line A off the stick. Rebound. Oh, what a save! Robin Leonard absolutely robs Mark Scheifele.
Desperation pays off. He extends that left glove hand. And take a look from overhead. It's first the leg save, and how about that? Not one, but two whacks at it, and then, wow.
Following up is White. Showing a little speed there to burst through. Colin White scores! A brilliant goal by White to tie it.
Now he skates into it and elevates it far down past Roberto Luongo. An unreal end-to-end rush for Colin White, and his 14th of the season ties it up.
Lifted back on by Orpik. Down the wing comes Connolly, odd man rush. Connolly on the curl and drag, fires, he scores! Brett Connolly makes it look easy.
He has got such great puck patience and confidence. That is a highlight reel goal for the ages.
And a giveaway by the Stars leads to McDavid cutting in. Oh! And what a goal by Connor McDavid. Oh my goodness. That's a highlight reel one there. Look at this. Bring it back between the legs, tuck it top shelf on the blocker side. No big deal.